I know how to do this in SQL. But, how do I do this in Python? If you already know data analysis with other tools like SQL or Excel, you may find it very frustrating the fact that you know what to do to clean up or manipulate your data, but not be able to translate the steps into Python code. If you can relate to this problem, this course is definitely for you. This three-part course will use your existing SQL knowledge and show you how you can not only translate the queries you already know, but also accomplish the same task using the advantages of the Pandas Python library. Hi, I am Alex and I will be your instructor for this course. In order to help you start with the basics, and then easily move to more advanced concepts, I divided the course in three parts. Part 1. Single table queries. In this part, we will first do all the prep you will need to run SQL on Jupyter, and then we will create a database that we will use along the course as our demo data. Once we have the basics in place, we will review examples showing you how to translate manipulations based on SQL clauses, select, from, where, limit, having, and, order by, into Pandas data frames. Part 2. Multi-table queries. In this part, we will build queries with several types of joins, and then we will translate them into Pandas. We will be building upon the knowledge from Part 1 and will also do more advanced type of queries, using information from multiple tables. Part 3. Advanced queries. In this part, we will explore different ways to manipulate complex query logic, as well as ways to reproduce data definition language actions such as create, alter, and drop. We will also cover examples that will help you enhance your repertoire of tricks in Pandas. Now it is time to get started. In this course, we will run both the Python code as well as the SQL queries using Jupyter notebooks. If you need additional details on how to run SQL on Jupyter and SQLite, I am including below a link to a video that walks you step by step how to do this. If you prefer to use another IDE or another database, please be free to do so. The results should not change. Before we start reviewing queries, we will create a database and import demo data. If you intend to follow this course by reproducing the steps, you should be able to create data in your own environment following the instructions in this video. If you just intend to watch this tutorial without reproducing the steps, you can skip the data preparation steps. Data preparation. Let's create a database and some demo data. Let's start by importing the Pandas and the SQLite libraries. Import Pandas as PD. Import SQLite 3. Then, let's create a connection to the database. In this case, as the database does not yet exist, the same command will also create the database. Let's name it world_cup.db. Then let's use the magic command load_ext to load the SQL module and then another magic to load the target database. Next, we will do the same procedures twice. The first time, we will create a Pandas data frame with the year, winner and runner-up of each Soccer World Cup. And then, in the second time, we will use a list of countries from Wikipedia to obtain the continent each country belongs to. Let's create a variable to store the URL with the Soccer World Cup finals data. Then, let's use the read_html method to store the list of tables in that web page as data frames. Let's then, repeat the same process for the page that has the list of countries by population. We will derive the relationship between country and region from that table. The data frame that we need is the third one in the list, so we will simply access the list and retrieve the data frame in position 2. Remember that Python uses a zero-based index. There you go. But we can see that we have lots of columns and also some rows are not relevant. For example, the years where the World Cup did not occur, or the years in the future are not relevant for us, so let's exclude them. To trim the years, we will do the following. Select the second data frame in the list as we did above. Then, select the columns using the square brackets and assigning it the list of columns we need to show from the table. If you do not fully understand it right now, do not worry, We will explain this in detail when we explain how to translate the SQL SELECT clause into Pandas. To simplify and avoid creating more variables, assign the result to the w_cup_df variable, which will override its contents. Let's see if we got what we needed. Perfect. Now we have a data frame with three columns. Exactly what we needed. Now, let's exclude the rows we do not need. We can see that rows 3, 4, 23, 24, 25, and 26 are not relevant. Let's use the drop method to exclude them. We can see that the year 1950 in row 5 has literal values. But, we need something we can translate into a number. So let's go ahead and assign 1950 using the at method. Now we have our table ready to be injected in the database. Let's clean up the country's data table. We will do a quick one-liner chain to perform three actions. Select the third data frame in the list. From this data frame, select the first and the second columns. And finally drop the last row of the table as it represents the total world population, and we do not need it for our analysis. We can see that the columns have complex names. Let's simplify them by assigning a new column names through a list with the labels columns and region to the columns property of the data frame. We can then check and see that the column names have been renamed. Finally, let's use the do_sql method and the connection we had already created to inject these data frames into the database. In the case below, we will be creating a table named world_cup. To create another table with the country list, you just need to repeat this same step, using the countries_df we created in this exercise. Before we proceed, let's see if the data got correctly saved in the database by retrieving it with SQL. Select, star, from, world_cup. Perfect, our tables are now in the database and ready for querying. Select statements. Select statements are the most basic structure you can have in a query, and that will be our starting point. Let's first select the entire word cup table with a select star query. Select, star, from, world_cup. Reproducing this query in Pandas is extremely easy. You only need to call the variable holding the data frame, and that's it. You just retrieved your table. Now, if instead of selecting all columns in the table, we want just to select the columns winner and year, in SQL this would be select winners, year, from, world_cup. In Pandas we can do it in a few different ways. We can do it by using the Pandas slicing in square brackets. In this case we just include a list of the columns we want to show inside the square brackets after the function. w_cup_df, and inside the brackets, winner and year. Another way to do this is to use the iloc method. The iloc method takes two arguments. The first corresponds to the indexes or rows of the data frame, and the second one corresponds to the columns. In this case, we will select the second column, winner, which is in position 1, and the year column in position 0. Yet another way to do that is to use the loc method. The loc method works in the same way the iloc method works, with the difference that instead of the columns numbers you can use the columns names directly in a list as the second argument. Another common type of select statement are the distinct select, when you want your results to only show unique records. In SQL this can be done with select distinct winners from world_cup. There you go. We have a distinct list of World Cup winners. One of the ways to reproduce this in Pandas is select the columns that you want to include, in this case winners, and then use the method drop_duplicates. There you go, we then have the same list of unique World Cup winners. Sorting columns. Another common operation in SQL is to sort columns. For example, let's sort our table, by year, in descending order. To accomplish the same in Pandas, we would use the sort_values method. w_cup_df.sort_values. Then as arguments we will use the column we want to use for sorting. In this case, year. We also need to set the ascending argument to false, so we can get the columns in descending order. Well, we got an error. But why? It looks like the sorting operation is not working. Let's inspect the data types of our data frame using the info method. we can see that the year columns has a object type. This means that either the values in the columns are strings, or, which is more likely given the error we got, the types are mixed between string and integer. To avoid this ambiguity, let's explicitly convert all values in the year column to integer using the asType method. We do that by simply chaining the method to the year column and reassigning it to the same column in the data frame. Once we do that, let's try again to sort the data frame using the sort_values method. As you can see, the values are now sorted in descending order. Selecting first or last rows in a table is also a common SQL operation. Let's first select the first 5 records of the table using the SQL clause limit. Select star from world_cup limit 5. We can see we have the 5 first records of the table. In Pandas, we can accomplish the same in a few different ways. We can simply use the sort_values method to sort the table by the desired columns. And then, apply the head method to select the number rows you want to retrieve. Note that, I explicitly passed a value of true to the ascending argument. The default value of this argument is set to true, so I would not need to do that to get the values in ascending order. I did it, so you could see the difference when we sort the values in descending order to get the records at the bottom of the table. Another way to get the first 5 rows is to use the iloc method, and explicitly indexate in the first argument that you want rows starting in position 0 until 5. Remember that the iloc method excludes the item in the closing range, so what we will really be getting are the values in position 0 until 4. A variation of the use of the limit clause is to use it in conjunction with the offset clause. The offset clause sets the position, counting from the top, where I will start retrieving records. We can obtain similar results using the iloc method, and specifying the position of the rows in the same way we did in the prior example. We have learned how to retrieve the top n records in a table. What if we want to get the top bottom records instead? In SQL, we just need to add the descending clause to the order by clause. Select star from world_cup order by year descending limit 5. There you go. We have the bottom 5 records. In Pandas, using the sort_values and the head method, we just need to change the value of the ascending argument from true to false. That's it. Using the iloc method, negative numbers invoke the records at the bottom of the data frame. We then just need to assign the number of records we want to retrieve, and to ensure we have them sorted in descending order, sort the resulting records using the sort_values method. Just for completeness, I will quickly go through the use of offset when sorted in descending order. It is just a permutation of the sort and limiting functionality we have already seen. So, first we will run the question in SQL. And then translate the same query to Pandas using the iloc and the sort_values method. Renaming columns. Many times, especially when you create a new column that is a derivation from an existing column, you want to, or have to use a new name in SQL. In SQL, you just need to use the keyword as to create an alias. Let's create a query using our World Cup table including the year columns but, renaming the winners columns to champions. In Pandas, you will use the rename method and assign a dictionary to the columns argument. The keys of the dictionary should be the columns you want to rename, and the values of the dictionary will be the new names. Just like we did in SQL, we will rename the columns winners to champions. Filtering tables. So far, we have not used any criteria to filter the results of the tables. Filtering in SQL is accomplished using the WHERE clause. Let's build a query from the World Cup table with records where the winners column equals Brazil. Select star from world_cup where winners equals Brazil. As we expected, now we only have the records of the years when Brazil won the World Cup. There are a few ways to do this in Pandas. The first way we will demonstrate leverages the concept of Boolean masking. In this case, we will filter the results of a data frame, only returning the values where the expression inside the brackets is true. So, to return the records with Brazil in the winners columns, we just need to create a logical test using the columns reference. w_cup_df.winners=Brazil. Another way to achieve the same, that may be very familiar to SQL users, is using the query method. You can then add an argument that is quite similar to your where clause, just needing to specify the columns and the operator. But what if you want to filter for multiple values or multiple criteria? In SQL, when you just need multiple items within a column, you just need to use the in operator. Select star from world_cup. Where winners in Brazil, Argentina. There you go. Let's adjust the code above to reproduce the SQL results. Now, in the Boolean mask, we just need to replace the equals operator by the isIn method and include the items we want to query for. Using the query method is even easier. We just need to replace the single item by the list. If multiple logical tests need to be performed in the same column, or if we need additional columns to be tested, in SQL we usually join the multiple criteria using the in operator. Let's add an additional criteria to the year columns and set our query to return results when either Brazil or Argentina won the World Cup, but only after 1980. In Pandas it is very similar, we just need to add the additional criteria to the Boolean mask and to the statement in the query method. As you see, identical results. Aggregation is an important technique in data analysis, and the group by clause in SQL is a very easy to use tool. Let's say that we want to know how many times each country won the Soccer World Cup. We would select the column we want to use in the aggregation and then use the aggregate function count to create a column. Lastly, we would just specify we want to aggregate by the winners columns and order the results in descending order. There is a very simple way to do the same in Pandas using the value_counts method. The value_counters method simply takes the columns you select and indicates how many times its contents get repeated. Another powerful way to do the same is to use the group by method. The group by method gives you the flexibility to group results using multiple aggregate functions. Let's see how the count example would work. I renamed and sorted the values, but if you are only looking for the aggregation, you could stop in the second line. There is one difference here though. You can see that the winners columns now became the index of the data frame. If you want to turn it into a regular columns, you just need to add the reset_index method to the chain, and we recover the data frame index. Now, to close the first part of this course, let's say if we want to modify the query above to only return national teams with more than 2 championship wins. In SQL you can do it with the HAVING clause, set to championships greater than 2. In Pandas it is even easier. Remember that by chaining methods you can use the results of the last items in the chain as your base. So to get the countries with more than 2 championships you only need to filter the results data frame using the query method, and applying the criteria, championships greater than 2. We just concluded part 1 of our SQL to Pandas series. In this part you learned to translate the most basic one table commands from SQL to Pandas. You learned how to retrieve results, select columns, rename columns, filter data frame by single and multiple criteria, as well as to aggregate results. In part 2 you will learn how to translate your multiple table queries to Pandas, including joins and other advanced multi-table manipulations. I hope you enjoyed the video. Please give us your feedback in the comments below, and if you have not yet subscribed, please hit the subscribe button to be notified about new videos like this.